we are going to pray for it. I want you to know, amen.
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 Good evening.
Good evening.
All right, like I said, we are going to pray for it.
That's right, amen.
This morning, we kind of start off a little differently today. This morning, I was at a prayer. Anybody else make prayer this morning? So, Sister Deborah came up. I was right in the middle of praying something very personal. I got a very personal situation coming down. I don't mind sharing a little of it with you all. If you all can pray for my brother, who just been in ministry for 3 months. And we know. So she kind of caught me in that when I wasn't really into a corporate prayer thing, and I was focused on praying for him and asked me to come up and start praying. So. But I was obedient.
Amen.
I hit the front. But in the process of that, there's some things that was impressed on my spirit and through prayer that I really didn't really articulate or respond to. I should have, but I didn't quite know how to get it out while I was praying, what God was telling me, because there was some things He was telling me and wanted me to pray on. I think I know why, because He didn't want me to pray on it right there, but He wants us to pray on it now. Can everybody turn their Bibles to 1 Timothy 2:1? And I just don't have to walk off and leave. Now, we're going to read this verse, and I'm going to go through it. Because a lot of what is coming down, and what we were praying for in prayer this morning, a lot of the situations that we find ourselves in, 1 Timothy 2:1. A lot of the situations we find ourselves in is because we don't understand, and that's why I get into teaching marriage, we don't understand foundational truth. We get away from foundational truth, and we want to go and just attack the situation or the problem with the word while the foundation is still eroded. So when the word might operate and function and do something for a minute, next thing you know, we're right back into the same old situation. We might have a minute of reprieve or a time of reprieve, but because there's no foundation to it, we fall right back into the same situation. I went and ran off and left my iPad. We got any strong readers in here? Somebody can read that for me. And I'm going to go through this and we're going to pray.
1 Timothy 2:1. I exalt therefore that first of all, supplication, prayer, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men.
Okay, stop right there for me, please. If you stop right there, out of what we've been learning here in this class, should spark something to you right quick.
Yes.
Should spark something to you right quick.
Yes.
You know him? Should spark something to you right quick.
Yes.
As to the foundation of what this really is all about. Said to what are men? Yes. And it says some men.
All men.
Where is it that you can say all men is in a position of authority?
Yes.
Put it together for me, saints. Come on.
That's right.
Where is it that you can say, not in government?
Nope.
Sure.
Because I still ain't got no authority in government.
No, nowhere but in the Bible. No word.
Not in the church?
No.
Because all men don't have a sense of authority in the church.
That's true.
The only place that all men, any man, can come into a position of authority is where?
The word.
The word. In the marriage.
Oh, in marriage.
Hey. In the marriage.
That's true.
In the marriage. That is the foundation of everything. And this really touched me this morning, that prayer, because we're praying and we're seeing, to me, we're kind of praying amiss because we're not addressing the foundation. He said, pray for all men. And man, this bring that again, because it gets an intensity. You're not just praying one type of prayer. We got to do this with a sense of intensity.
Yes.
We were doing supplication. And go yes. read it again for me, please.
I exalt, therefore, that first of all, supplications.
Supplications.
Prayer, yeah.
Go ahead.
Prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men.
For all men. Mm.
Mm.
Go ahead and read the rest of that.
For kings, go into the second one.
Yep,
for kings and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all good godliness and honesty.
Okay.
And honesty.
If you understand that, if you understand,
kings,
I'm gonna hand out some handouts here.
Oh,
first, it says all men, because there's a sense of what here? Order.
Where?
There's an order. Because out of that all men situation comes kings.
Kings.
People in authority in their situations.
Mm-hmm.
So we got to pray for the foundation first before we get to the government. Because we don't pray for the foundation first, all we're going to do is start feeding the government more wicked people.
Amen. Amen.
Ungodly people.
Amen.
Yeah.
If we don't get the foundation together first, all we're going to do is start feeding our churches, feeding our schools, feeding our community
with
ungodly people.
Amen. Amen.
Wow.
That's true.
Now I said churches. Because we got people walking up to churches trying to bring the world, they way out of order.
Yes, we said this today.
Yeah.
But the only reason they have that authority to walk in there and do that is because of what? Those who do know are not saying nothing.
Right, right. Stop them.
Those who brought them in this world are not saying nothing.
Mm-hmm. Ooh.
Because if I walked up and started doing something out of order when I was coming up, I don't care how old I was, my mom, my dad would have slapped me upside my head.
Yeah,
that's right.
In the name of Jesus.
neighbor too.
And a neighbor too?
No, that's right.
And a neighbor too? When I was young, a neighbor too. I can tell y'all some stories about that. A neighbor too, because the Bible teaches us that the younger are supposed to treat the older as if they are parents, paraphrasing, and the older are supposed to treat the younger as if they're their own kids.
That's right.
I'm paraphrasing.
Yeah.
But that is, and we're going to get into that relationship. We're going to get into that in terms of relationship with love. I'm going to mention that. But I feel, because of this morning, with you all learning the foundation of what all is all about, learning that that's where we need to repair the breaches at the sense of the marriage, that we can start producing, like I said before, when you come into church, you don't come into church in the front door, you come in the back door. We'll create some front door kids that when they come into the world, they're already sanctified. They're already filled with the Spirit. So we like that man in the Old Testament with his quiver full. When he releases that arrow, he's releasing one that is mighty, strong in the Lord. Not coming in the back door trying to learn the Lord to get to the altar. He's at the altar already.
Yes.
Y'all don't
amen.
Hear me.
Amen.
He's at the altar
amen.
Already.
Yes. Amen.
Amen. I mean, I'm using symbolism here. We know, we understand that the church is supposed to do that. But that was not God's original intent. God's original intent was for Adam and Eve to populate this world with godly, holy, priestly people.
Yes, that's yes, right. Yes.
That's right.
And his word hasn't changed.
That's right.
His word hasn't changed at all.
That's right.
So I'd like for us to kind of take time and pray in the Spirit and pray for that foundation, pray for marriage, and pray for men that are coming into authority in a marriage, and pray for women that have authority over their kids. Pray for that marriage. Pray for that sense of, because God told the man and the woman to have dominion together, have dominion over this world. Pray for that union to have an organization, a sense of togetherness, of oneness for that dominion over this world. So if you can, please bow your head and I will start along. Let's just pray in the Spirit here. Hallelujah. Oh, Father God, the head of the long door, the Ari Shake, we just come to you right now, Father God. Bring me the long door, now pray for all men in the door, Father God. Oh, yes, the Maria Melo. We come repent, Father God, that we did not pull Shake, that we did not come together and create here for you, godly people. But we know now, Father God, oh, Shahidi Amalondo. So we know now, Father God, that we are prepared to reach the marriage of the world with godly people, Father God, holy people, Father God. Oh, Yahdi Amalondo. The priests, the kings, Father God, that represent you, Father God, in the name of Jesus. We said it on the Hote Hayate. Humberto Huri Ayata. Humberto Huri Siki Pambero Ronde Adolute. Yeri Amaki Edolondo Fuhuta. And we thank you for Jesus, Father God, who died upon that cross. His obedience upon that cross, Father God, gave us the opportunity, that gift to come back to you, that we may represent you, Father God. Be filled with you, Father God. And populate this world, populate this earth as you would have it to be. So we decree, declare right now, Father God, that it's your will that shall be done. Your will shall be done on this earth, Father God, as it is in heaven, Father God. And we thank you. We thank you right now. Give you all the praise and glory. Give you all the praise and glory. For you, we know we read the end of the book. You win. We win, Father God. And we thank you for your grace that has taken us through our ignorance. Oh, we thank you for your grace, Father God, that has pulled into situations that we knew nothing of. We thank you for your grace, Father God, that when we walked in sin, we do know better. But now that we know better, we just give you all the praise and glory because you loved us first, Father God, and gave your Son for us. Oh, yeah, we just thank you right now, Father God, because you're awesome. Oh, you're the man. You gave me a new heart, a new start, a new being, a new friend. I just thank you for glory. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Glory. And we thank you for all men, all women, all those who are authority in our government, Father God. Whether they be evil, ungodly, we thank you for them. We thank you that you have given us the power to trample over wicked spirits. So in that, we pray for them also, Father God. For the prayers of a righteous man shall prevail much. And bind that spirit that holds back your will and deserve, Father God. We bind it now. We loose your praise, your worship. We loose your promise upon your people, Father God. And we know, Father God, that you be for us, that who can be against it, that no weapon formed against us shall prosper, Father God. So we walk with a boldness, knowing that you walk with us. And we proclaim it. We declare it in your Son Jesus Christ's name that victory is ours. Victory is ours. Victory is ours, Father God. We keep our eyes on you, not on our government, Father God. We keep our eyes on you because you are our banner. We keep our eyes on you because you are the standard by which we live by, Father God. We keep our eyes on you because your order. It's your order. It's your order, Father God, the way you have us do things, your righteousness that you have put in us, that will prevail, that has prevailed, that is prevailing. And we thank you, Father God. We give you praise and glory right now in Jesus Christ's name. And everybody say amen.
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 Yes. Father God, we come right back to you now. asking you to trespass the hills.
Yes, take the burden.
Oh, yeah, take my burden on you.
Hallelujah.
You know the situation that is going on, Father God. We need not to know the situations. We just need to know you.
Yes, Lord.
And as you release your peace, your power, your glory. Oh, yeah, yeah, in this situation, Father God. We stand in agreement with him and his wife that all things are working good for those who love Christ. And he loves you.
Yes.
So we know it's going to work out to his good, Father God.
Yes, it will. Hallelujah.
Hope will take him. He is our pastor. He is our representative for you, Father God.
Hallelujah.
So we ask you to protect him, guide, direct him, Father God. Him and his wife. Put him. Anoint him. A hedge of protection around the whole family, Father God. As they do things to sacrifice for us, Father God.
Yes, yes, yes. Hallelujah.
We pray for my brother, Father God.
Yes, Lord. Be with him always. Hallelujah.
Well, you know the situation that's going on there. He is not walking into a very peaceful situation. One that loves America, Father God.
Yes, bring him back.
He's walking into the enemy's camp. But we know you say in your songs.
Yes, Lord.
That you put a hedge of favoritism,
yes,
Father.
Yes, hallelujah.
Build that hedge of favoritism, Lord, Father, that he will find favor with whoever he comes with any man, Father God, that will protect him and direct him, Father God. No, Father, I ask you to give the rest of the family peace as they be away from us and doing your will, Father God. Let us not worry, but just pray, Father God. That this experience be one that will lift the whole family, Father God.
Yes, Lord. Yes,
and we give you praise, we give you glory, we thank you for all that you are, and the love that you have for us, shown through your Son, Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 No focus whatsoever. God bless. But that is the crux of what's really touched me this morning. One reason why I had to pray, because we're so busy praying for things. And there was things said, just some certain things. Ain't nobody asked me yet why I'm doing all this, so I'm going to tell you because it kind of comes in. If you go to number six, there's a thing in number six called the Nazarite Vow. Samson, just all your major men in the Bible went through a process of doing this from time to time. You can do it for a lifetime or you can do it for a period of time. Basically, it just all it does is it's more than just a fast. Separation. So I've kind of turned off the TV and separated myself from the world. Number six. And then give you the crux of what's going on with me. So like I said, it's kind of it's more than a fast, it's a separation. So I've turned off the TV so I don't exactly know what's going on. I kind of hear things. And what was said this morning is about the Obamacare being appeal or what happened? They voted it down. The thing that goes against Obamacare, they voted it down. They call it Trump Care.
But he didn't accept it. He said he's not gonna call it Trump Care.
Yeah, I'll well, get ready to hit that hands. Because he called it Trump Care. The reason why that's what touched me. He called it Trump Care and Obamacare, and it kind of shows we're looking at things from a governmental point of view because for some reason. Yesterday, I saw a brief headline, and I wondered, why ain't gonna show me just this headline? But no, I'm separation, I'm separated, I didn't really want to hear. But the headline said that Trump immediately, this is all I saw, Trump immediately called down and told him to take it off the floor. That told me that because that told me that that's God working. You know, we can't look at Trump, we can't look at We got to look at, we got to see God working.
Yes, and
I pray this morning that we come to the realization, don't put your trust, get your mind off the government.
What's getting ready
to happen, if you put any stock into what's going on in the government right now, it's going to upset you because God is doing the shaking.
That's right.
He's revealing some things. It's kind of like what I used to tell my wife. I said, if you don't have your religion together, don't go to because you'll lose your religion real quick. Anyway. You will lose your religion real quick. We're going to cut that out of the table. That's kind of what's going on. I believe when Trump came into this whole thing, and he gives you the sign that it's not him, that it is God. Because if he came in with his intelligence, you'll be thinking that it's him and not God. But he came God, not him. He got in there with God wanted to show you that it's not this man doing this, but God using this man to shake up some things. So don't put your heart, your trust, your interest in what's going on in the government right now. Don't team up about Democrat, Republican, because this whole situation in this country needs a shaking. And God's getting ready to shake it from his foundation to bring us back to him. And I seriously believe, because if you read Revelation, I believe that America, a lot of people think that, I'll give you a little history, a lot of people read Revelation, they think that Satan is going to rule the world. No, Satan is not going to rule the world, because there's going to be a faction of the world that's going to come against Satan at Armageddon. Who is that? You ever thought about that? Because if he ruled the world, there would be no Armageddon.
There would not be that
final battle. We know one of them is going to be Israel, but Israel is going to have several other nations behind him going to battle against the Antichrist and Satan and Armageddon. Who is that? I seriously believe that's going to be America. America is going to be one of those countries. Because there's a spot in Revelation that tell you that the wings of the eagle is going to separate from the lion. And if you get into the symbolism, the lion is Great Britain. The wings of the eagle represents the United States. We're going to be separated, set aside, and ready to charge.
Amen. Yeah,
but
come on. Shout.
That's why you got an awesome revival going on right here in America right now. A lot of people don't realize. But let's get down to the message. That's a little bit of Bobby. That's 1 Timothy. We left off, at least one hand those out now. We left off last week with Genesis 2:18, going into, and what we're talking about right now, we're in the God's love for man, the relationship of God's love for man. We're kind of setting that order of the relationship of God's love for man. So kind of go back. We define this thing of relationship. I'll let her hand all over. We define what relationship is. Can anybody tell me what a relationship is? You got your definition, don't you? What's relationship?
Okay. The way in which two or more persons are connected, the state of being connected,
or the state of being connected.
Or the state of being connected. State of being connected. There's two words you need to really concentrate and focus on, and that's connected and way, which also translates order. So you want to focus on that God is creating an order in which we are connected to him, a border in which we are to love him. And that's what we're talking about right now. This is part of his love for us. He created the order, and his love for us In the order that he created his love for us, first he created Adam, then came Eve, then came mankind. We go on that way. But in that order that he created for us, we left off in Genesis 2:18 and discussing that order. There's another part in there that we're going to get into a little later in that order where Adam said, for this reason, a man should leave. We'll get into the marriage part. I'm going to mention now. For this reason, a man should leave his family, paraphrasing, and cling to his wife. We're going to get into that. But that's been so distorted, thrown out a lot of question, not understanding what cleaving means. You know, and a lot of people, especially in African Americans, we have missed our heritage because of that. We think that we're supposed to leave our family, that the man leaves his family, not understanding that the financial heritage comes through the man. So we our counterparts are just getting rich and fat. None of them made it on their own. They made it because of that heritage that they got from their parents.
Yes.
But we kind of, and the Bible says a good man does what? Leave an inheritance to his children. So why would this all of a sudden contradict that? Because we kind of twisted it the wrong way. But we're going to get into that. So we left off in Genesis 18 talking about God's love towards us. That's what we're talking about. God's love towards us. It's not our love, not us loving him, but his love towards us. So he created us, and he created us male and female, sanctifying the marriage, ordaining the marriage, and told us to have dominion, told him to have dominion over everything and populate this world with godly people. But something happened. Something happened. Let's go to Genesis, and up until that time, should have had godly people come into the world. So Adam and Eve was in the image of God. But something happened. Let's go to Genesis 5:1. At least you want to read that one? I'm going to show you something real quick. And it's going to create and show you the necessity of salvation. Glory to God. Show you why every time you realize your salvation, the gift of salvation, or why you should be just praising Jesus like
all
the time.
Amen.
Not only did he take your sins, but anyway, go to Genesis 5:1. Okay. Go ahead, go read it.
In this book, the written record of the history, I'm reading the Amplified, of the generations of the offspring of Adam, when God created man, he made him in the likeness of God.
Oh, right there. Mm-hmm. When God created man, we can stop and say man by that point. You can say man, Adam, but we can also say man, Adam, and Eve at that point because the original sin has not been created. So Eve had the godliness. Eve had it also. So when they come together, they created that image and likeness of God. Go ahead.
He created them, male and female, and blessed them and named them both Adam, man, in the time they were created.
Okay.
At the time they were created.
So he interjects the same word Adam and man to represent Adam and Eve as being
one.
Just like Denise and I, you can call us the Downs.
Yes, yes.
You know, or you can call Pastor Hill, Mrs. Hill, the Hills.
Yes,
you know,
yes.
That's the Hill family.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
A quick statement, Miss Hill.
What's that?
This is ironic. When I was little, when I first came into church, my pastor's name was Hill.
Well, you see, look to the hills.
I'm looking to the hills.
I thought of that just off the cuff.
Go ahead, Dee.
Number three?
Yeah, keep reading.
When Adam had lived 130 years, he had a son in his own likeness, after his image, and he named him Seth.
All right, Adam had lived how long?
130 years.
Understand that Adam, after 130 years, during this 130-year process, Adam and Eve have fallen.
Right.
That's why God said now his son is not in the image and likeness of God. His right. son is in the image of Adam.
Yes.
Fallen Adam.
Yes.
So when we're born, we're not in God's image. We may be God's creation, but we're not even God's children.
Amen.
We're not God's. That is why it's so important to have the rebirth, because in the New Testament, it tells you the first Adam is the Adam of what?
Oh,
born of the flesh.
Born of flesh.
The first Adam is the Adam of the flesh, because he fell. And when we're born, we're born of, but God is spirit. To get back into God, now we got to have the rebirth to be born of the spirit. That is why Jesus Christ is so important.
Yes.
So important. The mistake Adam did in the original sin took us out of the image and likeness of God. And somehow, I can't really explain it, because what had happened, somehow when that sin had happened, God has no death in him.
Right.
Adam in the beginning had no death in him.
That's true.
But after
That's
that
right.
sin, death injected into Adam's spirit.
Mm-hmm.
That is why we die. But Jesus came that we might have life and have it more abundantly.
Yes, yes.
Jesus came that our life may be eternal, that we may never die again. Because now we are born of the Spirit. Okay? Order. I'm talking about order. God's order of love for us. But God created all this knowing, out of love, knowing what we will go through. He created an order, a process, a way that we can stay connected with him. That's relationship. He never forsaken that relationship. Even in our sin, he had relationship with us. Because he had an order, a means by which we could stay connected with him.
Yes.
Without getting into it too deeply, because in that order, Adam, Noah, Abraham gave us the means to stay in connection with God.
Yes.
God gave them the means by which to stay in connection,
right.
and that was faith.
Yes.
Through faith.
Yes.
Through faith in what? Through faith in Jesus Christ, knowing that which was going to come.
Yes.
So that's God's order of love for us. That's God's way staying connected with us. Let's look at a few of those ways. Now let me make this statement also. Because it's God's way, God's love is going to dictate that order. We can't change it. It's God's love, God's order. So he dictates that way. So you have to keep that in mind. And that's what all the great men of faith did. They understood that. It's not my way. They just took faith in it, even though they couldn't understand it, couldn't see it. They just took faith in it. And that's what God loved them because, and promoted them because of that faith they had. But let's look at a few things here. Let's go to John 3:16. Everybody knows this one. God so loved the world, he gave. So God so loved the world, he gave. We all know that one. John 3:16. God so loved the world, he gave. So he gave. That's his process. Because we didn't love him, we didn't even know him, but he gave. He gave. So he created the Lord. He gave. Let's look at this a little deeper and see how he related that to his people. Let's go to Deuteronomy 7:7. How God had this relationship with his people. When his people that he created was rejecting him. Deuteronomy 7:7. Want to read that, Dee? So anybody else want to read?
I read. The Lord did not set his love upon you and choose you because you were more in number than any other people.
So this shows us that God has a determination to have a relationship with us.
Yes.
He did not do what he said. Not that we did anything, it's what he did. Mm-hmm. And not because we were so great, or speaking of Israel at that time, they were so great, and Israel was a reflection of the church of us right now. Not that we were so great, but because of...
You were the fewest of all people.
Because we're the fewest of all people. That's what Israel, because Israel was the fewest of all people.
That's right. Yes.
So he wanted to show himself. He didn't want to get great people. He's trying to show, use Israel to show the world who he is.
Right.
He's trying to have a relationship with the world, one person at a time, actually. Because he didn't want us to have kings and queens. He wanted us as individuals. God is so massive, so great, as individuals, we can come to him and be led by him. We didn't need a king. You don't need a king. We don't need a government. If we all was connected into Christ himself, like we should be. And that's the original way God intended it to be.
Yes.
He was upset when Israel started asking for us to be like the rest of the world. He wanted each individual to come to him as an individual and have that relationship with him themselves. But he created his order created a means to maintain his relationship with us. Let's go to Deuteronomy 10:17. Trying to show you something real quick. We're talking about God's love for us. His relationship with us. So why are we talking about this so tough? Because if you grasp the understanding of God's relationship with us, if you grasp the understanding of the relationship of love, you can understand the relationship of love in your own marriage.
That's true. Amen.
We're trying to rebuild the foundation.
Yes.
We ain't trying. We're going to do it.
Amen.
We're going to rebuild this foundation. So people, when they come in here, get this understanding, and they stand in their marriages, they're going to stand in the marriage and represent God, reflect God, totality of who and what he is. And I mean, they're going to stand as man and wife and going to speak and right before your eyes. You're going to see things happen. That's what God did. That's what Adam did. And that's what we're going to do.
Amen.
But first we got to prepare this foundation.
Yes.
And get rid of these walls so we can come together. Start speaking in agreement and changing things.
Amen.
Okay, you want to read 10:17, Deuteronomy 10:17?
For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great, the almighty, the terrible God, who is not partial and takes no bribe.
So what does that say? That he's almighty.
Yes.
He's coming to you as being almighty.
Yes.
He will not compromise.
That's right. Amen.
He's going to maintain what he says. He's not going to say one thing one day and say something else the next day. You can stand on his orders and know that it will be.
Amen.
Trust in him. Trust in what he says.
Yes.
And we're going to get into here a little bit why we don't trust him. Let's go to Jeremiah 31:3. I'm trying to build God's order of love for us to get us to understand that we can trust in that order, that we can trust in what he said. So when he says, when you read in the Bible, particularly with young women being endanged with this society right now, when you read that it says submit to your husband, you are not... You will understand it first and then trust in it. Because in Psalms and Proverbs, it tells us And I noticed this the other day. You never, I have seen anywhere in the Bible where it puts down understanding. But it puts down knowledge. It says knowledge puffeth up.
Yeah.
But it says get understanding. Mm-hmm. And all your understanding, get understanding.
Yeah, understanding. Yep.
Get all the understanding you get. I don't care what knowledge, get the understanding of it.
Yeah.
That's right.
Because when you get the understanding of it, you don't get so puffed up. You get humble.
Mm-hmm. You get humble, yeah.
But when you think you got something that somebody else got, you get a little puffed up and you wanna get a little egotistical and bang people over the head. Look what I do. You know, type of. But the Bible does not put down understanding. It says get all understanding you can get. So that's what we're gonna do. We're gonna get understanding. We're not just gonna get married. We're gonna trust and have faith in God, but we're gonna seek understanding like it's our life dependent on it. So we got Jeremiah 31:3. Did we do that one?
No,
not yet. Go ahead.
The Lord appeared from of old to me, Israel, saying, yes, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn you and continued my faithfulness to you.
That's God again. I mean, Israel representing us, the world, going off like crazy, but God is constantly kind of interjecting. Listen to me, man. God is kind of interjecting, coming in, telling you, hey, I love you. I love you. Not only did I create you, but I love you. He's maintaining that order of relationship. He's not forsaking you. He's not giving up on you. He's not sitting back just letting you destroy yourself. He's doing that today. Might be talking about Israel right now in the words that Denise is reading, but he's the same God today.
That's right.
And he's knocking on each and every one of our doors the same way. Mm-hmm. I mean, we all of them tell stories before we can say that, hey, man, I don't know what saved me from that, but I should have been dead by now.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. Love of God.
Love of God.
Love of God.
Yes.
Let's go to John. We did John 3:16. Let's go to Ephesians 2:4. Establishing that love that God has for you, that order, that way, that means by what he is staying connected to you. We can personalize this. All of God's words, you can personalize it because you are Israel. You are the church. You are mankind. You are his creation. Ephesians 2:4. Go ahead.
Ephesians?
Yeah.
2:4.
Okay.
Talking relationship now. We've got marriage, and I'm going to go over that. We're going to go over our definitions. We're building upon our definition that we learned in previous classes. Mm-hmm. All right, go ahead.
But God, so rich is he in his mercy, because of and in order to satisfy the great and wonderful and intense love with which he loved us.
Oh.
Mm. Wow.
Ooh. Oh.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Wow. Yeah.
Rich.
God has got so much built up in himself that he is about to explode. And it kind of, I don't know about you, it really makes me feel foolish that some of the things I do, knowing that God loves me this way. Why are some of the things I ignore his word, even though I might not understand it? It's just like a child. A parent telling the child, no, you can't go to that party.
Mm-hmm.
Knowing what that party was all about.
Yeah.
But yet, in our ignorance, I want to go.
Yeah.
Throw our little fitsy because we want to go. We want to be like the world.
Yeah,
the world.
That's it.
But see, that's the problem. We're trying to be like the world on a different level.
That's true.
Uh-huh. We are trying our best. But God's love for us, his order for us, this way of staying connected to us, he's not going to let us go forsake us, even in our stupidest times. A Understand me, church. Understand me. Last one, and then I'm going to go a little further. 1 John 3:1. So I'm going to take it to the next stage of this. It's our love for him, what happened. 1 John 3:1. Everybody there? Okay, go ahead.
See what an incredible quality of love the Father has given.
Whoa.
Shown, bestowed on us, that we should be permitted to be named and called and counted the children of God. And so we are. The reason that the world does not know, recognize, acknowledges us is that it does not know, recognize, acknowledge him.
Yeah, all right.
Oh, man, that don't quite bring tears to your eyes right there.
Wow.
Our God loves us beyond all comprehension, really. Let's go to 2 Peter 2:1, and I'm going to take us into, this should take us into the next part of that, which is our love for him. 2 Peter 1:4. Now, when we get through with this, you all gonna have to talk to me. You're gonna have to talk to me, kind of let me know. You ready? Everybody there?
Mm-hmm.
All right, 2 Peter.
By me.
2 Peter 1:4.
By means of these, he has bestowed on us his precious and exceedingly great promises, so that through them we may escape by flight from the moral decay, the rottenness and corruption that is in the world because of covetousness, which is lust and greed, and become sharers, partakers of the divine nature.
All right. So we've got to escape the world. He has given us a means to escape the world. What is the world's ideology? What is the world's definition of love? Talk to me, come on. What is the world's definition of love?
I think it's anything goes.
Anything goes. Anything goes. What's the world's definition of love?
I'll love you if you love me. I'll treat you right if you treat me right.
You, yeah. There you go.
I'll be faithful to you
if you
be
faithful to me.
Well, conditional.
The world's definition of the world is to take.
Yeah.
It's to take.
Take all you can while you can.
Don't take all you can while you can. It's to take. But that whole definition is just wrapped up in that last part that we're trying to escape from, which he read. Denise, you want to read that last part again? That last part that we're trying to escape from of the world. One was lust.
Corruption. Lust and greed.
Greed.
Covetousness.
Covetousness.
Rottenness and corruption.
Rottenness and corruption.
That's part of moral decay.
Yep. So the world definition of love, the world, the way it expresses love, is in greed, lust. Right? Moral decay. Because if you think about, I was kind of a musician, and I saw how music was going, being in music. It seemed to me that look at music. Music, people were trying to be more creative. In their effort to be more creative, they became more decadent. Mm. It seemed like the more she took off, the better the record sold. Mm-hmm. The more they started to cuss, the better the record sold.
Yeah.
The greater the flamboyant, wicked, nastiest production they could put on, the greater the production was. Because I know a lot of us, and I saw music, because I was into music, but the Alice Coopers were doing crazy stuff on stage that I couldn't even mention here right now. But back when I was into music, I was like, oh man, did you see that? Now that I think about it, I didn't want to see that. Why did I want to see that? Because there was a move in the world towards decadence, towards wickedness, towards all that which is evil. You know, like I say, you had Alice Coopers, you had all those high rock, and then it progressed into what they call now acid rock, where they were showing up looking like something crazy out of the graveyard, and banging and doing all that. But that's what that was, the move. Mm-hmm. Become more creative. Not to become more creative in a godly way, but the world was becoming more creative in a demonic way. So the world's ideal of love is kind of like, not no kind of to it, it's the opposite of what God's ideal of love is, God's order of love is. So if you think about it, anything that comes against, destroys God's way, is the world's way. Anything that comes against, takes you out of God's way, you have now left that and you become the world's way. Eve, listening to the serpent, took on the world's way, took authority, gave to Adam. Adam, in his reflect, and I can get into that a little bit, but I'm not going to. I can say this one thing about that. Adam and Eve acted in the way that they were created without their creator. They got out of order.
Yeah.
Adam was created like God. He acted like God, but without God. What do you mean by that? Adam saw what Eve had did. Eve acted like Adam, but without Adam, and took authority.
Mm-hmm.
Adam acted like God, but without God, and sacrificed himself.
Mm-hmm.
Don't make a doctrine out of this, but it's an order there. There is an order there. Because if you're going to jump on Adam and say, why Adam let Eve did that, do this and do that, why, then you're jumping on God himself too, because God was right there watching the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
But he had to allow them, in the free will that he created them to be, he had to allow them to make their decision.
Yeah.
But you have to understand, you can't act outside of yourself. I know, because I'm bringing this up because we have taken this whole Adam and Eve thing and has thrown it into male bashing and thrown it into this and thrown it into that. And we've taken Adam out of the character when Adam was created. We've taken Eve out of the character when Eve created. And it's all so simple.
Mm-hmm.
They can't act out of what they have been created. Eve was created from Adam, meaning she created out of a sense of authority. She just acted out of a sense of authority without including Adam. Had the final authority. Adam, being created in the image of God, acted out of a sense of God and sacrificed himself, but did it without finding up the way that God had.
Mm-hmm.
That's why the second Adam said, what? I do nothing but what my father showed me.
That's right.
What
to
do. Mm-hmm. Tell you that they didn't do that.
Mm-hmm.
But he's going to do that.
Mm-hmm.
He's going to stay in order. Jesus is going to stay in order because God has the plan to keep us connected.
Amen.
They got out of the plan to keep us connected.
Right. Amen.
So with that in mind, we're getting into the world's way. I want to. Did we hand out the definition?
Mm-hmm.
I got these definitions because this definition, if you get them down in you, get them down in your heart, it can be a foundation by which you can govern everything that comes. Because we're supposed to try the spirits.
Mm-hmm.
And God created the border based on the marriage. Mm-hmm. God created the border based on an individual.
That's right.
So when you see an individual step up, that's why I truly believe that the Antichrist is not going to be buried. When the Antichrist steps in his position, he's not going to be buried. He's going to be out of order. Yeah. If you understand this order, you'll be able to recognize things that are out of order. That don't mean they're totally out of order. That don't mean they're going to become the Antichrist. But that gives you a means by what Papa Hagen used to tell us, how to chew the straw and spit out the sticks. How to chew the straw and spit out the sticks. Because nobody right now is coming in perfect. You have to study these things for yourself. Don't put your faith in nobody but God. When something comes up, you weigh it against the word.
Amen. Yes.
And I hope you all are studying out what I'm telling you. Don't just sit up and say, Minister Michael said. Somebody come to me and tell me that you said Minister Michael said. I'm like, hey. You better talk to the Lord with that. Yes, Minister Michael said. No, Holy Spirit said through Minister Michael. So let's read over those definitions real quick. Somebody want to read them for me? Before we go any further into man's love for God. Man's love for the world. What's the first one? Yeah. What's marriage?
Marriage, yes.
Marriage is what?
Male and female coming together in the reflection and image and likeness of God.
What's the second one?
Love.
What's love?
God's spirit.
God. Love is God. Mm-hmm. Love is spirit. Mm-hmm. Now also we put on there that love, God gave us a spirit of what? Power, love, and a sound mind. Yes. So that same spirit he gave is in us. Mm-hmm. That's the gift that we've got. That same spirit is in us. And covenant is what?
An unbreakable bond, irrevocable. Inseparable bond between God and man.
Mm-hmm. If it's between man and man, it could be a contract, agreement.
That's right.
And they're breakable. But when God makes a bond, makes an agreement with man, and he's made all agreements he's going to make with us, mm-hmm. we just have to accept it. That's the gift. Promises that he's already made. He's not going to make any more promises.
Right.
So if you got somebody to come in into the religious world and starts talking about he got more promises from God, that's to turn a light bulb on in your head.
Yes.
Because the covenants that have been made has been made. All of them have been made with us, and God is not breaking any of them.
Yes.
He doesn't need to make any more. Mm-hmm. And he won't make any more. There's no more covenant, no more promises. We just have to learn of the ones we have.
Yes.
So to bring all that together and to bring us into where we are now, what's relationship?
The way of order in which two or more persons are connected.
The
state of being connected.
A state of being, I like that though, a state of being, because it's one thing, it's a thing that we got to constantly work at. Mm-hmm. It's a state of being connected. We have to constantly work at it. God has already provided his way. God that did his work. Mm-hmm. He did his work, and on the seventh day he did what?
Rested.
He rested.
Rested.
Now he's working. He's waiting on us to work out mm-hmm. our salvation.
Mm-hmm.
It's our time to work out our salvation. He worked out our salvation.
Yes.
He got the plan in order. He gave his son. Everything is laid out all the way to Revelation.
Mm-hmm.
It's all been laid out. Now we've just got to believe and rest in him.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Amen.
And part of resting in him is understanding the foundation of it all is marriage.
Yes.
Part of resting in him is knowing that when we have that marriage that is created by him, led by him, directed by him, that we're producing godly and holy kids.
Mm-hmm.
It's part of his order that when we produce those godly kids, they go out and produce a godly government.
Mm-hmm.
Part of that order that if we produce a godly government, then we have a godly nation.
Yes.
It's part of that order that if we have a godly nation, then we're going to rule the world.
Amen.
But who has to have dominion first? Who has to have dominion first? The marriage.
The marriage.
He gave that dominion to you, the marriage. Not just the male, strutting her ego. Not just the woman, strutting her figure. But when they both come together, I just gave you the truth. Because in the world, we're talking about in the world, it's egotistical men that seem to be getting ahead. In the world, it's women who are willing to show themselves and want to get ahead. I'm not just talking about in the music world. You want to come with me in the corporate world? Lyles is down, and they do it on purpose. Lyles is down here, and they come to you. This is what I want you to do. Are we all of them? I'm sorry.
She's doing
the
homework.
No, no, no.
That's
too late.
She's
got to
hear
it. Oh, no. But that's the reality in the corporate world.
That's true.
That's why we really have to pray for men. We pray for women, but we really have to pray for men because Satan has used the woman to distract men in so many ways. I mean, when I was coming up, you turned on the TV and we had I Love Lucy and what's up? The little boy with the freckles.
Dennis the Menace.
And so they had these families and everybody was dressed right. And then the commercials there. Now these little boys now. Now these young boys now they turn on the TV, they see all kind of perversions, and not only that, they turn on commercials, they got a woman jumping across the stage with underwear on. A young boy, and I know you ladies don't really fully understand this, but a young boy in puberty is out of control. And you're going to take a young lady with underwear and you blowing his mind.
Wow.
He don't know what to do. He's just going. So you got all this sexual perversion and crazy mess going on out here. That's the world. That is why it's so important that we got to reestablish this foundation called the marriage. You got to take dominion back.
Mm-hmm.
Take dominion back as a marriage. I still got a little time for y'all get with Denise's corner. I thought I had went over there for a minute. So take these definitions. I want you to apply them to everything we say in here. We've gone through the love in terms of what God's direction is, God's order, God's way, but we've hit on man's love for God, which is perverted, the world's love. Now we want to touch on man's love for women. Male for female. I want to touch on that. Somebody tell me something about that? Man's love for women. We can tell that real quick. What does the word say about that? You don't have to give me scripture. This be right up front. There is plenty of scriptures I can quote. Male for female. Let's y'all take it a little bit too deep, and sometimes we do that. And I tell everybody I counsel in marriage, first thing you gotta do before I'm gonna put this right out for first thing you gotta understand when you love one another, you gotta love them first as what? An individual, a child of God. You gotta love them as an individual, not as your prospective mate, but as an individual. And the word tells us a lot about loving each other. The word says a lot on how we're supposed to love each other. It's love, I'm going to write straight up.
Oh, okay, one is love your neighbor as yourself.
Love your neighbor as yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're loving your neighbor as yourself, isn't your mate your neighbor?
Mm-hmm.
Is there any difference for the love I have for my wife Denise and the love I would have for Mrs. Hill?
Yes.
The love itself, there is no difference. The love itself, there is no difference. The order by which we stay connected is different. The covenant, the order by which, I do not have a covenant with Miss Hill. So the order by which I stay connected with Miss Hill is different than the order I stay by which connected to my wife. Because I have a covenant with her. I'm in covenant with her. But the love itself, the love I share for her, is no different than the love I would share for Mrs. Hill.
Right.
The love itself, not the order, the love. Because if I begin to treat Mrs. Hill differently and above my wife, then I'm out of order. Because the covenant puts her first. But the love itself, if we're in a situation where somebody walked down that door, if my wife is safe and Mrs. Hill needs protection, I'm going to die for her too. My wife might have to moan a little bit if I do. But I am not going to let nobody hurt. If I'm not using Mrs. Hill, but I'm talking about any and everybody in here. Because it's not that I'm thinking about who it is, I'm just reacting as to who I am. And that's how God does. You don't think about who it is, you just react as to who you are. And I have a spirit of love.
Yes.
So I'm going to act out of love. And that's what Adam did. Everybody comprehend that? We got it? I see some faces right there. See, because we're looking at the order. We're trying to look at the order, not the love itself.
Right.
Because the love I have for my wife is no different than the love I have for my daughter.
Right.
I'm going to protect my daughter just as diligently and just as vigorously as I do my wife. But in order, my wife comes first. So my daughter says, I need this. My wife said, I need that. Well, it's my wife first and my daughter. See, there's an order that's been created. God created it. And that's God who created that order. We didn't create that order. That's what I'm trying to get at. God created that order. And that's why I was trying to show you, and we're going to get into it deeper. We started off with the order he created with Adam and Eve. And then it progresses from Adam and Eve to the kids. Then it progresses from the kids to those outside the household. There's an order that God created, an order of love. The problem is when we begin to give that order of love back, we get out of order. We want to do things out of order because of the world. We got into the world's love. The world perverts that order and makes you get out of it and do things. The world will make some, we got little kids. The world will make people do stupid stuff to their kids. That's perverted order. That's the devil. That's the world. Perverting that order to God. The world will make you do stupid stuff in terms of with other women, or women with other men, and all that kind of stuff. Pervert that order. But God's order is from marriage, Adam and Eve, their relationship, to the kids' relationship, to the neighborhood, and progresses on out. But once you understand that, foundations can be truly built.
Yes.
Foundation. And I must kind of put this back out here. This is not for you to go home and beat your spouse up. This is for you to get strong within yourself to support your spouse. Or another marriage. So the relationship between man and women, between male and female, out of the love of order, there's no difference. That love itself is no different. Don't let the world
change
it, pervert it in any way. If you are love, you're going to act in love.
That's right.
And that is the key thing, is why we must be born again. If you are love, you can act only one way. That's why I put it down simply. when my wife's not around and a young lady walks up, I open the door. Mm-hmm. Because that's who I am.
That's right.
My wife is there, and if there's a choice between that young lady and my wife, my wife gets first.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And you know what? After she gets in, I turn and I go to the young lady.
Amen.
Let the young lady in. Because I can't just, if that's who you are, truly who you are, you just can't be it, turn it on and off.
That's right.
You are who you are.
That's right.
It's not something, when you truly act out of the love that God has given you, it is who you are. You don't turn it on and off. You don't make a choice that I'm going to be a hard-nosed one day.
Right, right.
And then I'm going to reflect the love of Christ in that. You don't sit up and I'm going to knock you upside your head one day, and then I'm going to forgive you the next. Or what Pastor Scales was talking about. You don't sit up and cuss out that driver. Cuss out the driver because they cut in front of you.
That's right.
You stay in love. And you just bless them. I bless you. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Stay in love.
Yeah.
Stay in that love walk.
Yes.
Any questions? I'm running out of time. Any questions? So we've been through kind of with love and the relationship between love as God's order relationship, and that's what a relationship is. It creates an order. Man's order of love or towards the world, and man's order of love towards each other.
Yeah,
any
question?
Yeah. Any question? Yeah.
I was just going to say, what you're saying now about the order, that's kind of like what we had in prayer today about Satan got an order too.
Satan has an order.
Uh-huh, so
he's the world.
Yeah.
He's the one that's perverting all this.
Yeah.
He is the world.
So
next week we're going to jump on covenant. Next week we're going to go through the same order. God's, I think it's covenant. And we're going to go through the same order. God, then man, then between each other.
Mm-hmm.
So we get this up. I'm going to drill this in you. We're going to get this in you. You walk, you're going to walk in the foundation of understanding. That's what's going to strengthen your faith.
Amen.
We're going to have understanding. A while ago, the Lord told me, he said, my people are playing these roles and they don't even know what the play is all about. Talking about married people. He said, they're playing these roles and don't even know what the play is all about.
I know that's right.
So therefore, we don't have power coming out of marriage. We made a statement here a little while ago about having a form of godliness and no power. And we see, not hear that, not hear marriage. I know it was put in a different context, but I hear marriage. Mm-hmm. But without further ado, because she don't have much time, I'll cut into a little time. Denise's Corner, come right here.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening. Good evening.
We forgot to celebrate and thank Mrs. Hill for our snack tonight.
Oh,
thank
you. Yes.
Yes. Thank you. Yes. Thank you. Yes. Thank you. Thank you.
That was it.
Heart healthy.
Yeah. What was that, Sister Dorothy?
Heart healthy.
Oh, yeah.
Heart healthy.
Yes, pretty healthy.
Well, I'd like to talk today about relationships. Growing up godly children.
Mm-hmm.
You know, God has a plan and a purpose, and He uses everything that He has allowed us to go through, He uses it for our good, so that He can get the glory, you know, and so that He can get the purpose out for what He has for us. Mm-hmm. See, a lot of things that we go through, it's a learning process.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and God takes that learning process and uses it for His good.
Mm-hmm.
So the same with, okay. So we need to learn to trust and cling and rely and depend on Him. You know, because God is the Alpha and the Omega. Mm-hmm. He's the first and the last. Mm-hmm. So we can count on Him and depend on Him that He has everything in order for us. Mm-hmm. Even though we go through some things, you know, He allows that because He will need you to go to help somebody else. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so that you would be so sympathetic and understanding and have that fiery, like, I've been through this, mm-hmm. you know, so I know. And so you have that fervor that mm-hmm. Pastor was talking about to pray mm-hmm. because you've gone through it. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just like, you know, us telling, you know, somebody that's having a baby. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, you just had a baby, what, a couple months ago?
No,
so,
a year ago.
Yeah.
He's walking now.
Yeah. 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 Sorry.
That's okay.
But well, you're probably the most recent one among us. Yeah. Seems like a few months ago. But if, you know, while you were pregnant, you know, you could have come around and asked any of us women who's had kids mm-hmm. to tell you, well, tell me about, you know, what am I supposed to expect when I'm going to go in labor? Mm-hmm. You know, and so we're able to say, tell you because we've gone through it. Mm-hmm. And those that have gone through it most recently, like you, you'd be able to tell somebody else, you've been a year, you know, you'd really be able to, yeah, you can do it, you know, and you yeah. can encourage them. You know, so that's why God allows us to go through things so that we can help and teach others, mm-hmm. you know, and have that fervency, mm-hmm. you know, to let them know it's okay, you're going to make it. Mm-hmm. We can go through that. Mm-hmm. And so when we're raising up our children, you know, God tells us to raise them up, to train them up, mm-hmm. you know, so that they will not depart, mm-hmm. you know, from the Lord. So we're supposed to grow them up in the Lord. Mm-hmm. But part of the part as we're growing up children, we have to be an example to them. Mm-hmm. And our example, because our children mm-hmm. see us and watch us more so mm-hmm. than they hear us. You know, my daughter used to tell me, you know, Mom, you give us orders of 5 different things. I only heard the first and the last. I didn't hear what you said in the middle, you know. You know, so the same thing. So when you're talking to them, they only hear part, mm-hmm. but when they see you, they see it all, mm-hmm. you know, and that image stays with them. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's very important that as we're raising mm-hmm. up godly kids, we have to raise up, you know, show them godly wives, mm-hmm. godly mothers, mm-hmm. godly fathers, you know, godly right. husbands, you know, so that's what they're learning from. Mm-hmm. And you notice sometimes that a lot of your children, not all of them, but some of them, will get a husband or a wife that's similar to the mom or the dad, mm-hmm. you know, either in appearance or yes. in personality, yes. you know, because they watched you. And they like that, mm-hmm. you know. So now I want a wife that has those qualities, you know. So that's why examples are so important. And what I found as part of my, what I felt was my job with my kids was that I was always watching out for distractions. You know, my kids were athletes. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they play sports. You know, my daughter ran track, got an athletic scholarship. My son, he played baseball. He played everything, but he majored in baseball. Mm-hmm. And so he also had a scholarship. So as they were growing up, you know, we were teaching them, you know, how you deal with the coach, how you deal with anger and losing and all of that, you know. So, you know, we were teaching them things about that. And so like, especially when they got in college, I think it was even more so when we were looking at distractions. But as they were younger, I remember teaching them how to pick their friends, mm-hmm. you know, and I did it in a way that, you know, now they're getting older and, you know, so they need to learn to discern and that's how to pick their friends, right. you know. Mm-hmm. So I can't pick them for them, but I'm teaching them, you need to do such and such, mm-hmm. you know. And then I watch how they pick their friends. Mm-hmm.
And so as it got older, you know, I'm watching, I'm saying, hey, listen, you know, so-and-so is, you know, there's a distraction here, you know, you need to get rid of that, you know. But first I would always pray. I said, Lord, I'm seeing this, you know, and how do I deal with this, you know, because I want to get in there and nip it in the bud, so I've got to come to God and ask him for his direction so that I can get rid of it right away. And with God, it's much easier if we go to him, because he shows us how to do that. So I was always on the lookout, because I didn't allow any distractions that are coming from Satan. I wouldn't give him an inch. I wouldn't give him a minute. You know, and I'm going to tell you another example, is that when my daughter went to college, because they were so athletic and so busy, you know, I didn't have to deal with a lot of boyfriends or girlfriend issues, you know, because they were just super busy. But there was another distraction that just totally caught me off guard, and that was female friendships. You know, and I don't know if you all have ever gone through it. As you all are younger, I don't know if you've ever been through it, but I had never dealt with, you know, because my daughter liked, this is just in her makeup. She would always, you know, go to a person that's sitting off as a wallflower. How you doing? You okay? Everything all right? You know, and that's the love of God in her. However, you know, she ran into this one girl that, you asked her how her day was, and man, she's giving you an hour scenario, you know? And then after that, my daughter was so tired, she didn't feel like going to her track practice that she had to go to. And so she started missing, you know? The coach calls up and says, hey, this is going on. We're like, what? You know, and I'm like, and now she's far away now, you know? So I really got to pray, okay, we got to get through, because I can't lay my hands on her. So, but that was another distraction, you know. So I found that my role as a mother was always watching out for distractions. You know, if there's a distraction that came up to allow them not to finish their homework, you know, or to not pass this test. I mean, I don't care what it was. If there was a distraction, I had to deal with it. And I mainly dealt with it through prayer. You know, because I had to get God's direction, you know, you know, you have to learn how to not react, but you have to learn how to respond. And I could only respond after I got direction from God. Because if I react, I'm reacting in the flesh. You know, I mean, I can get with it in the flesh, you know, but that's not, you know, that's not really going to work necessarily. You know, he was the type of person that you couldn't really yell at him. You know, it would just do something to his whole makeup. You know, now Michael, all has to do is call his name, and that's it. He stops in his tracks. You know, but me, you know, I call him. I'm getting frustrated. I'm calling them, you know, again and again, you know. So I just kind of learned his makeup was a little bit different. I had to deal with him differently. So I always had to seek God. How do I deal with this? Which way do I go on this situation? You know, so in that, you know, I have to learn how to respond, you know. Although I remember snatching him one time, you know, I just had to... You know, because my thing is like, okay, listen, you got three strikes and you're out. You know, just like in baseball. You can relate to that. My son is in baseball, you know. So, but anyway, not having to go through that example. I don't want to embarrass him, even though he's not here, but he's a little older now. But also in the discipline, you know, we're always... You know, like I said, to respond, because we always want to follow God, because God is going to give us the discipline, but then he's also going to give us the love, you know. And so I'm always trying to see, to discipline my kids as God has disciplined me. You know, God disciplines me with the word, with correction, you know, with conviction, you know, but I always know that love is there.
Because all I got to do is say, God, forgive me, I did wrong. You know, and you just kind of get that warmth of love around you, you know. So that's always what I wanted to do with my kids. I wanted to, you know, tell them what they did wrong, you know, and then give them that love hug, you know, so that they know that everything is okay. I still love you, you know, but I just don't like that you did this, that, and the other, you know. So we're always, you know, we're supposed to build up our kids.
That's right.
You know, we're not supposed to tear them down.
That's right.
And you know, our words are very strong, so we can tear somebody down in a minute.
Yes.
But a little tender, you know, child, you know, you don't want to, you know, tear them down with
That's
words,
right.
mm-hmm. you know, because then we run into, then we get into another area and we get on Satan's side of the field.
That's right.
You know, that wants to tear you down, you know, and we do it so bad, you never be able to, you know, mend back up. And, you know, men are very, are you know, you can tear, you know, you can tear down a
delicate,
man so bad,
yeah, delicate,
you know, and I know you all know that there are some men that have never recovered from what a woman has done to them, you know, because they're so, they're I don't know, just vulnerable, they're just, they're really tender-hearted, you know, women can be really, you know, really tough, you know. But a man, I mean, we can really, and you know, we say that, you know, we think that that's cute and it sounds good, you know, I can be tough, but you know, that's, you're jumping over in Satan's territory, and that's not where we're supposed to be. We're supposed to stay here, you know, and be loving and kind and disciplined and strict, but yet and still you're doing it in love. You know, and you're using God's word, and that's what's important, you know. I hate to say that I just kind of cringe, you know, when I hear somebody, when I hear either a parent or a teacher, you know, and they just, you know, strike them down with their words, you know, and they don't know how they're injuring
correction.
That child's spirit. You know, there's a way of correction, but it should be in love. You know, now we're supposed to discipline in love, you know, and but we don't tear them down, you know, and there's a fine line in that.
While you're on that.
Yes, ma'am.
I don't know if it really gets my goat or whatever. When walking to a grocery store, and like she got a one-year-old baby, and the mother's absolutely cussing the baby out if it's crying, and it's a year old, and she about 26 or 18 or something, and they wouldn't want me to cuss them out in the store like that, and the little kids are just crying, and they don't know what, all they know is that mama's hollering at them. They don't know the words, but they'll catch on later on, and I just hate it.
And they go on, and
on,
they go on,
at
and
home,
they go on, you know, so I mean, then they just
tearing
you know,
them down.
Yeah,
constantly.
Yeah, so in the spirit world, in the spirit realm, you know, they're getting, they're going like this,
right,
their spirit, little
right.
spirit's going down and
down,
and they may never recover.
That's true.
You know, and that's reacting to the situation.
Right.
You know, like, you know, like all kids, you know, they go in the store, I want this, give me this, give me this, and I'm going to act a fool in the store, and they're going to yak and cry and everything. Well, what I did with my kids, I turn around to in the back seat, I said, listen, you got two ask me, or I want, and that's it. I said, now don't clown in the store.
That's right.
You know, I said, because I'm going to wait and get you home, and I'll tear you up. You know, now I'm more warning you.
Yeah.
Exactly what's going to happen. I'm letting you know. I'll give you two. You know, and I had to do that because they clowned in the store, you know, and I reacted. And I thought, dang, that's not what I was supposed to do. That didn't feel good to me, you know.
Right.
So I had to pre-warn them, you know. Just like with my son, you know, he was a strong-willed child. And, you know, Michael, that's why he's basically Michael's son. He looks like Michael, but he has my personality, you know. So Michael had to really work with him. So anything Michael says, even now, today, if Michael says something, that's law.
That's right.
I can't come back there and say, well, you know, we don't have to do it. He said, oh, no, Mom. Daddy said. And that came from 4 years of, you know, of working with them, with
that's
with
right.
him, you know. And so
you know, so my son was a strong-willed kid, you know. And so I thought, oh man, but you know, this guy goes to kindergarten, he's gonna get kicked out of school. You know? And so every morning I would lay down the law to him and say, listen, he get out the, I open up the door to get out the car so he can go into the nursery school. And I said, listen, let me tell you something. I said, don't let the teacher have to call me to come get you. I said, because if that happens, I'm going to whip your butt. And I said, not only am I going to whip your butt, but I'm going to do it in front of the class. And I said, and not only am I going to do it in front of the class, but I'm going to pull your pants down, whoop your butt in front of the class. You know? And I think I did that for like 60 days. I never got a call. But I felt like I had to tell him this, you know, because he was quick to anger, get angry. He'll snap and he'll punch you, you know, and beat up on his sister, you know. And I thought, oh man, I can't go with this boy, you know, 3 years old. So I had to instill that in him, you know, and never had a problem ever. I don't know why I was so worried, but I mean, I never did. Okay. Let me see if I got everything. Hold on a minute. Because there was something else. So one of the things with children, because they are, you know, new spirits, don't know a lot, their spirit is very new, you know, we need to speak those things into our children's spirits. Mm-hmm. So that they would gravitate. Whatever you speak, you know how, you know the negative side of it. If you say you're dumb, you're stupid, you're this, da, 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 you know, they kind of lead that way. Yeah. You know.
Yeah.
So just the opposite. If you say you're the child of God, mm-hmm. you know, you got the spirit of love in you. You mm-hmm. got the spirit of wisdom. They're going to rise to that occasion. You know.
Yes.
And so one of the prayers that I did with my kids, especially my son, because he's strong-willed. Was say, God, and so I would pray in his hearing.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't go off in my room and pray. I prayed in their hearing so they could hear.
Mm-hmm.
And what I would say is that you have this, God, give them the spirit of love,
mm-hmm.
the spirit of wisdom, the spirit of excellence.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And God, he is a God-fearing young man.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, God, open up his ears so that he can hear.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And not only hear you, but follow you.
Mm-hmm.
And that was my prayer. I prayed that over my son since he was in the sixth grade,
mm-hmm.
up until he got out of probably ninth grade, mm-hmm. maybe a little longer. But he rose to that occasion.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's got the spirit of excellence all over him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's got God's favor all over
yes.
him.
Yes.
And it just amazes us how, you know, where did you get all this favor? Well, you know, I met so-and-so and they did. I'm like, what? You do that? You know, where did that come from? You know? But so the praying for your kids is very important.
Absolutely.
You know, and I don't know if I said this before, but I can't say it enough, is that I also gave them each individual 5-10 minutes a day,
mm-hmm.
right
yes.
before they go to bed. Mm-hmm. Hey, how was your day? What's going on?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I did that so I know that after I put them to bed, I'm going back to pray.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, we got these situations going on.
Right.
I'm taking care of this in the spirit tonight.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I
mm-hmm.
developed a habit of them expecting,
beautiful.
Mama's going to ask me this, I'm going to tell them about this.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm trying to keep an open line of communication,
yes. mm-hmm.
so that they would come to me and when they really got something big
mm-hmm.
going on,
mm-hmm.
you know, and so they're expecting that, and it becomes a habit.
Yes.
You know, and my son, when he went off to college and he would come home for the weekend, and if our light and bedroom door was open, he would come in and he'd sit next to us now. We're like, what is he doing sitting in here? You know? And then it dawned on me, I said, oh yeah, he's used to us talking before he goes to bed.
Yeah.
You know, I'm thinking he's in college, you know. You know, and so I was just surprised of the habit,
yes,
that the good habit that you set with your kids, how important that was. Amen. You know, and they're going to do it with their kids.
Mm-hmm.
So we're passing things on and on, you know, all the good stuff we're passing down.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So they'll go from our kids to grandkids to mm-hmm. great-grandkids.
Yes.
All right.
Good. Amen.
Amen. Yes. Amen. Yes. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Amen. Amen. God bless. God bless.
Amen.
Yes. Yes.
What's he talking about? What I'm trying to teach y'all,
generation. We're
building that foundation in the marriage.
Yes.
Building those godly kids, what God commanded us and gave us dominion to do in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
We was holy, but that don't mean if we missed it that it's all over with.
That's right.
Don't even think. But what you learn here today will give you the strength, give you the knowledge to teach others, to pray for others, and to know what to pray for others. Any questions? You don't know how you blessed me with your smile because you were gone for a while and I was... Keep on smiling.
Yes.
Keep on smiling. Both of you are. But that's what this class is all about. We're not getting, like other various classes, get into the pleasure of marriage, about going out and when to date and when to have date night and all that mess.
Yes.
We're trying to build a foundation, strengthen this foundation. We're not going to get into women being from Venus and man being from Mars and all that kind of stuff. We want to get back to the foundation of what God has created marriage for. Because if I can get you back to the foundation, like I say, what God created marriage for, not only created marriage, but created you as an individual, being born again with the spirit of love, you understand that you are love, you're going to act in love, and everything else will fall into place. Everything else will fall because you have no other way to act but what you are. And if you act out of love with God, still in the control and throne of your heart, ain't nothing you can't accomplish. Ain't nothing you can't accomplish as a marriage or as an individual. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, in the name of the Lord, Savior Jesus Christ, we come to you right now, Father God, just thanking you for this evening. Thank you for each and every individual that showed up today. Thank you for each and every individual that wanted to be here that couldn't make it today, Father God, for whatever reason. We ask you to touch them, heal them, give them a peace if necessary. Do what it is that they need, Father, to satisfy that need in their lives. And those that are here today, Father God, I just ask you to give them safe passage to their home, Father God, that when they make it to their home, that they will walk into a shalom home, a peaceful home, Father God, and that the knowledge and information that they gathered this evening, I bind Satan, he will not take it from their head or their heart, Father God, that they will grow in it. And become that godly person that you want them to be. So we just give you praise and glory and thanks for being a God and God all by yourself. Until
yes.
Next week, Father God, I just ask you to protect them, direct them, and I plead the blood of Jesus over each and every one of them. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.